as well.
Okay, thank you. So, hi.
Sorry, Massimo, just before you get into this, can somebody just out of the audience just pop a quick confirmation in the Q&A that it's sort of brilliant. Just I'm sitting there thinking we've been chatting away. Just wanted to make sure that Massimo and I aren't talking to each other. Great, that's great. So yeah, if you just carry on now, Massimo, sorry for interrupting that.
Okay, no problem. So again, good evening, everyone. I hope you had a great Monday, or you are having a great Monday. So I'm Massimo Crippa, and tonight we will talk about Swagger. Okay. So first, a big thank to Mike Stevenson and the whole biztalk 360 team for organizing this session and for the whole Integration Monday initiative. So what about me? I'm Italian, and I'm working in Belgium at Codit. Codit is a company 100% focused on integration, which means on premise, on the cloud, which means IoT, API management, and other nice things. Within Codit, I'm normally busy with an old-fashioned guy called biztalk, and I'm also responsible for API management competence center. If you want to know something more about Codit, check out this website, codit.eu. Okay, this is the agenda of tonight. So first we will see what is Swagger and the component in the Swagger framework. Then we will see how to integrate our API server code with the documentation methodology. Then we will see the Swagger UI integration with Azure Active Directory, and at the end, the integration with some API management product. In recent years, we have seen a massive explosion in the growth of Web API and the rich applications that are consuming this Web API. API, you know, it's not a new concept at all. However, the modern API, and with modern API I mean RESTful API, are creating a sort of business miracle, and they are creating changing the whole IT landscape. Cloud computing, IoT, big data are, for example, the main driving force of this impressive growth. And today, APIs are the primary interface for every technology-driven product and services. The API economy we are living in today, it's all about unlocking additional businesses, business from our service, from our data, our competencies in general. So this API economy that we are living in today has been formed in terms of both API technology advantages and business opportunities. Here I put, you can find some business advantages like leverage new market or for example increase brand presence, which means for example sharing your data with partners and reaching that way a whole new set of audiences. And for example, your partner in turn can extend the value of your data and create something even more valuable. From a technical point of view, API have advantages like simplicity. So with an API, it's easy to build an ecosystem. It's easy to integrate with a mobile application. And also it should be, and it is easy to be used by developers. So, which means that when there is a new functionality, I mean, a new API, a better API with the same functionality, switching to the new API should be a small effort. And then here in this list, for example, there is an API can help us to enable a composite enterprise approach. So breaking down our business in a small composable block and then reconfigure this block to compose a new service or a new functionality. Okay, so from one side this help with the component reuse, and from the other side we can, for example, move part of our non-core business to external providers and cloud services. Okay, so we saw that APIs are easy to be managed, are cool, but what makes an API successful? For sure, an API should be valuable, it should be useful, but also it should be accessible, usable, and discoverable. A successful API is the one that it's easy to consume. So no matter what, if you are developing an API for an internal use, for a B2B use, or for the public use, providing an effective documentation can drive the API adoption more than any other tool. So a proper documentation not only helps the API intake, but it also a key factor, especially this in API management space, is a key factor to retain the developer and in general the consumer. So the longer it takes the developer to perform the first, let's say, hello world, that is one of the metrics for a successful API, okay, easier it's probable that this developer will move away if it takes longer. Okay. So what I want to say here, that the documentation and in general the developer experience is crucial for our to build a successful API. So recently we have seen the emergence of different trends to describe API the API such as for example Swagger, RAML, or API Blueprint, but out of all of these many specification formats out there, okay, Swagger is certainly the most popular. Okay, so what is Swagger? So Swagger is a description language for REST API. It's around JSON, where we can specify metadata, structure, data models, and then we will see more in detail in the next slide. But there is more than a specification, okay? Swagger comes with an editor interface, okay? This is the contract first approach. The editor, the Swagger editor, can be used to edit the API specification in YAML, okay? And then that is a language that is more human readable, and then to produce the JSON that is more machine readable. It comes also in the Swagger framework, there is a Swagger UI, okay? This is a set of assets like HTML, JavaScript, and CSS, that is a dependency-free set of resources. The UI consumes the Swagger JSON specification in order to produce an interactive documentation of our API. And then we have a rich set of tools that we can use to consume, for example, the Swagger JSON specification to generate client code. So for example, create our SDK, tools for to consume the Swagger JSON to create server code, and also tools to, on the other way around, to produce the Swagger JSON documentation in sync with the service implementation. The Swagger project was started in around 2011 by a company called Reverb, and in March 2015, so this year, it has been acquired by SmartBear, that now has the leadership project that still remain open source, as it will remain open source, of course. So let's see a little this Swagger specification. Okay, in it's quite straightforward. As I said, it's built around JSON. Okay, in the first part we have the metadata section, which, for example, you can see we have the description of the API, we have the Swagger version, we have the term of service agreement. In that case, I can explain how the data can be used. If there is a post with a request that the consumer can make through the API, okay? Then I have tags. Tags normally are used to group resources. So for example, we can create one tag per controller, talking about web API, modern API. And then you can see there are highlighted some part like the schemes, and here you specify if your API is an HTTP only, or it can also be both HTTP and HTTPS. Then there is the path section that points to the operation with the HTTP verbs, status code, and the schema references. Okay, so here, for example, I have one parameter that is a this parameter is passed to the post using the post to the path operation, let's say. And in that case, I can specify the schema, so the data model of the path object directly in this parameter, or in that case, having a pointer to the object definition session section where I define my data model. Then we have also in here we specify this operation, which type of security, if there is a security for this operation. In that case, there is this post, it uses an OAuth authentication to secure the data, the assets. Then finally, at the bottom of the file, we have the object definition part with the security object and the data models. We can define the parameters like skip. We can define the responsive of our API. Okay, so the object defining every single fields with the data type, and then what are the security model that we implement with our API. And in that case, there is you can see that the pet store this part of JSON is an extraction of an extract from the pet store default example, and you can see here there is an OAuth defined, and also API keys are used in this example. Then we have editors. Okay, here I want to show you quickly three editors: the Swagger editor, API Studio, and RESTless Studio. So I just switch to my here. Okay, so all of these are web application where I can edit my API specification. I can build up my API specification here on the left, and then get an interactive documentation here on the right. So for example, I can load any different example here if I want to learn more about YAML and check what is the syntax. In that case, I do new. So here I can specify, I can really, an API specification first approach. It's I'm really going to design using this editor my API. Here, okay, and you can see, as I was saying, we have a visual documentation here on the right. The YAML is automatically validated, so if I just do some mistakes like this, he will warn me on the right. And then, for example, here I can just like consumes. I think that I have jumped to line 2. Okay, let me do it again. So if I say consumes, I have to be very careful because it's case sensitive. Okay, and then here I can check I can design the whole my specification, and then in this case you can see that I have try operation, but because I don't have I didn't specify the host, I didn't specify the base path, so there are information missing. We are designing the operation. There is no API at this time. Okay, so I cannot test it. What I can do once I finish my to design my API, I can download the JSON and check what is the result in JSON. Okay, so I don't have to know all of this, how to set it up, how to write JSON, let me say. Okay, And then I can coming back here, I can generate server code or I can generate client code. A more interesting editor is API Studio. In that case, with API Studio is very cool because it combines the Swagger editor and another library that's called swagger.js that dynamically create a mocked version of the API. Okay. And here, for example, you can see we have this L operation. So if I just specify, I can specify the parameters and you can see there is a sort of IntelliSense. And then I can also specify, I also have snippets. So in that case, I don't have to know by remembering all of the YAML language to specify my new to design my API. So in that case, just say, let's specify a temperature parameter. Let's say that is it's in query string, so it's temp in Celsius, for example, and the type is integer. Okay, so now my API is it's okay. I can try this operation because it's, you can see here, I hope you can see, it's auto mocked. So if you can test your API, you can validate your API. And again, here you can download the code or you can download the JSON. Another example of editor I want to show you is a RESTlet Studio. Okay, here the approach is completely different. I don't have to know the YAML syntax to produce the swagger.json because it's a cross-format tool. Okay, so I can create here my first API with my description and so on. These are the tag. So for example, if I have a session controller here, and then I can start designing my sessions, okay, so get sessions, okay, for example, this is the methods that I want, and then here, for example, is just imagine that it's a get session by ID. I say that I want the ID, say ID, and so on. And then I can add the responses, so name, okay, status code, it will be 200, for example, and this is a session object, etc., etc. So I can define in that way, design using this cross-format interface my API, and then generate the Swagger, or in that case, generate the YAML. And at the end of the story, I can, as the other tools, I can generate the client SDK or the server, the API stub at the server side. Okay. Let's move back to the slide deck. Okay. And then we have the Swagger UI. It's also, this is in the Swagger framework. The Swagger UI is really an ultimate UI and it's very useful for developers to understand and to test the API. I imagine that all of you already know this UI, but let's check it out very quickly. Okay, we can consume a Swagger JSON endpoint. Okay. And it produces interactive documentation, so we can drill down with the operation, we can check what are the methods, we can check what are the parameters and all of the type that are defined in our specification. And then finally, we can try out our API. So, okay, this one is the pet store default example. This is the user experience. You can see all of the methods, the verbs, and then you can see the data model here. You can click and then edit and post and try out your API, analyze the response body and all of the headers that you got back from your API. So that's very useful for developers to to easily test their API. Tools. Okay, so we said that among all of the specification formats, Swagger is the most popular, right? So Swagger is the language agnostic, and that thinks it helped with the growth of a broad base of tools in a different language. So we have tools for Java, Node, Ruby, .NET, you name it. Okay. And here I want to just focus on the tools for .NET. And basically here we have two open source tools. One is called AutoREST, and we can use this tool to generate client code to invoke API. I would say that let's keep these things, and if we have time, we'll see at the end of the session. And then we have Swashbuckle. Okay, let's see what Swashbuckle is. Okay, Swashbuckle it's a .NET library to auto-generate the Swagger JSON, the specification of our API, starting from the API implementation, so starting from our API code. What does Swashbuckle do? It uses the API Explorer object, it uses reflection and XML comments to generate our Swagger JSON output. The main idea of Swashbuckle is to try to auto-generate as much as possible via reflection, so we don't have to focus on the documentation, and we let Swashbuckle to generate all of the specification that can be sometimes quite complicated to produce. And then if the output that has been generated by Swashbuckle is not, there is something that needs to be modified, we have extensibility point, okay? So we can modify the JSON output to shape it in the way we want. Swagger, basically, sorry, Swashbuckle basically does two things. It produces a discoverable endpoint, Swagger endpoint, so one per version, and it bundles this discoverable Swagger endpoint with the user interface. Okay, then once you have your Swagger endpoint, you can share with your team, and they can use this endpoint with different tools or with the Swagger UI to check their implementation and test the API. So let's see how it works. It's now we have the version 5.2.1. It has a minimal impact on our API. We have only to install, to reference a couple, let's say three DLL, okay? And automatically we have all of our endpoint generated. Okay, let's see how it works. So here I have this very basic API. The scope of this demo is not is very basic API. I want just only to show to you how to activate the Swashbuckle. So I point to my API. I open the package manager console. So I install my package, and in that case, it's a classical basic default web API. So I have to use the Swashbuckle package. Okay, this is done. Okay, so what happened then? It add this class, the Swagger config class, that basically is auto-registered when the application starts. You can see it here. And what it does, it creates the discoverable endpoint, this configuration, this command, and then here it enables the Swagger UI, nothing more than this. Here you can find different parameters, you can find different accessibility point, but the main idea here is just only to show to you that it's very easy to enable this tool on our implementation. After that, I can check it out. This is a very basic API. There is nothing special. You can see here the controller. There are it's really the values controller, okay, that returns two objects. Debug, okay, start new instance. So by default, the Swagger endpoint will have, let's go back here, Swagger config, we will have the base part of my API plus the Swagger and the docs dot and then slash v1. Let's see it here. No? Okay, so this is the discoverable endpoint. If we open it, we can see the Swagger specification is automatically generated by Swashbuckle. Okay, so, and I can see better here. Okay, this is all auto-generated. And then we have embedded our Swagger UI console, and we can just go drill down through the operation and try it out. Okay, like this. Okay, so nothing special here. So let's move to another example. What I have here is, let me move this. I think here, yeah, I have this this API. Okay, it's an example API that get back some information from a TV series, a famous TV series a couple of years ago, okay? Something about characters, something about episode, and something about season finale. Okay, what I want to share here with you is just the configuration that I did for this API. This is hosted, is using the Owen middleware. So here the experience is a little different. You have only not used the Swashbuckle, not installed the NuGet package Swashbuckle, but you have to install only the swashbuckle.core. And then you have to go on the startup OAuth, and then maybe it's better to show you. This is the default experience with Owen. So in here, I have only to say once I created the I referenced my swashbuckle.core. I've only used this extension method of the HTTP configuration object to enable the endpoint and enable the Swagger UI. In my case, I want to show again. I come back here. I create a separate class, and here I build up my Owen configuration. You have to specify the Swagger, you have to register Swagger as the in the beginning of your pipeline. And here I put all of my configuration. Okay. So first here I have some metadata. Okay, so those lines, some metadata of my, I added some metadata for my like description, the term of service of my service. Then I have include comments. This is very useful to describe the operation and other additional information of my API. So if I go to the character controller, I can include so the API, the Swashbuckle read all of the documentation, sorry, all of the comments from the XML output. And in order to produce this XML, I have to set it up my my API here and say that I have to produce the XML documentation file. And then I have to reference here in the Swagger config, I have to reference to that file that I have then to deploy to my web server. Then I have some filter. The filter are the extensibility point. I can use those filter to modify the JSON that is produced by Swashbuckle. An example here, I have this schema filter. Let me see. I use this schema filter to change. And just imagine that here I want to use. I want to produce a particular example that I want to post to my API with a different code number or whatever. So I don't. It's not enough, or I don't like what is generated by default. I can use this extensibility point. Okay, and notice here, for example, that I change the address of my Swagger specification file, and also I change the address of my Swagger UI. Okay, so let's see a little how it works. Like this, so I think it's here. So adding this simple configuration, I can have all of the description of my operation. So I can, and all of these things are read from the XML comments. If I don't want to use the XML comment, I can also add something like if I want to specify which operation the API returns. So for example, I have here not only the status code 200, but I can have different status code depending on the implementation of my API. I can do the things using XML comment, or for example, I can use these attributes like Swagger response and then specify what is the status code that I want to return. Okay. And now just imagine that I want, I have also this season finale, and here for the season finale I want to protect this this season finale method with using OAuth. So in order to access to the season finale data, you need to be authenticated. And I want to use Azure Active Directory as an identity server. Okay. So from a Swagger point of view, what I have to do, or also let's see, from a OWIN point of view or Web API point of view, I have to specify that I want to use Azure Active Directory as a authorization server. Okay. So I need to specify what is the tenant and what is the resource ID that needs to be validated within this OAuth configuration. And then here, coming back to my Swagger config, I have to set up some few things. So first, I have to set up what is the OAuth, let's say, tag and the description, and more important, which flow I want to use. Okay, so here I can use two flow, the implicit flow and the authorization code flow, because think that we have four OAuth flow. Okay, implicit and authorization code are the flows that requires, that has a user is in user interaction in their definition, so it doesn't make sense use the other two flows that are more service to service. Okay, and moreover, also the Swagger UI also supports these two flows. Then I have the scopes that I want to use. Okay, scopes is important to define different access level to my API. And then let's say I need to create, first let's check this one, I have to add, to specify which operation needs to be secured, okay? And in Swashbuckle, I can do the things only using this filter, an operation filter, and I got this example from here. This is the GitHub page of the Swashbuckle. If you go in a dummy core, you can find, and then in Swagger extension, okay, you can find here all of the different examples on how to use, how to extend, how to configure Swashbuckle to have this accessibility point. So here I have this what security requirement, and what I did, I took this, I got this configuration from here, and I put the here in my implementation. Okay. So what I do here, this is the ID of the authorization that I set it up in my API here in the Swagger config. So they should match, of course. And then okay, and then I use in this case some custom authorization attribute to specify that, for example, this controller needs to be authorized with only a specific role, in this case authorization authorized user. Okay, in on other controllers, for example, here, let's see if I have more scopes here. Yeah, still authorized user. Okay, but if I need other scope, I can just use my API role. Okay, dot administrator. Those are the two roles that I defined. Okay, good. So coming back, so to here, then I need to enable the OAuth. Here I have to specify the client ID that has been generated from Azure Active Directory. So every time that I want to create an application that access to my data on behalf of me, I have to register this this application is in Azure Active Directory. So what I did here, let me go to Azure Active Directory. Okay. So here what I have to do, I have to create a new application and say that, for example, my application that is called Swagger UI for Integration Monday. Okay. So here I have to specify the redirect URI of the Swagger UI application. So in that case, it's something like HTTP localhost, and here it depends if you change the default URI of your Swagger user interface or not. In my case, it will be something like, I mean, by default it will be something like Swagger UI, and then O2C. If I remember well, something like .html. Okay, let's do it like this. I don't remember by heart this value, but I already created here my... So, in this case, this is the client ID that I need to put in that position. So, let's see the configuration, because I want to give you this one, redirect URL, URIs, okay? So this is where Azure Active Directory will send back the authorization token to my API. And then last things here, two things I have to do. First, the Azure Active Directory doesn't when we use Azure Active Directory, the implicit flow is not enabled by default, so we have to go here, manage the manifest, download the manifest. Okay, edit the manifest, and here, okay, we have to edit this implicit flow from false to true, save our manifest, and then, okay, upload it again. I already did that things, so for this Swagger API, Swagger UI API, the the configuration is already set up properly. This is A7B, it's my, coming back here, it's my, yeah, it's my client ID. Okay, and then this is the trick, because with the current version of Swagger UI, the integration with Active Directory doesn't work. Why? Because if you work with OAuth and Azure ID, the resource ID, and the resource ID is the ID of your web API. So first, before registering this Swagger UI, you have first to say that your API is a secured you have first to define your API, and here you specify the API that you need to connect. So you use something that is called resource ID. This resource ID identify your API. It's a unique identifier within your Active Directory. So by default with Swagger UI, you cannot pass this parameter to Azure Active Directory. So what did I do here? I create a custom assets, so I can overwrite this JSON that I added, sorry, this JavaScript file. I override it here, okay, in my external customization library. I got this one from this, I got this JS from the Swagger GitHub repository. And then I hard-coded here this additional query string parameter, and I pass it here at the end. So I just added these three lines that I found it on a forum, on GitHub, and then I define here this my resource ID. So in that case, I can pass the resource ID to Azure Active Directory. What I have to do to include these custom assets in my Swashbuckle deployment and then use it, I have to mark the resource as embedded, and that's it. Okay, once I build my external customization library, I can here in the Swagger config add the custom assets with this configuration. Okay, then I can build and deploy my my web API. I have it here, or maybe let's see in a new encounter window. So this is my web API that is hosted in Azure. First, I want to show the result of the customization that I've done, because I have the impression that especially the part of with OAuth was not super clear. I'm sorry for that. So what I want to say here, why we use a filter, because let's see like this. So here at the bottom of the file, we have we define our security configuration. But then for every operation, I have to specify which operation needs to be secured, and that's why I use that filter. That filter go through, read all of the operations in my web API and apply this security to this operation. In that case, let me see which operation it is, this one. So it's the get characters by keyword, and also I have season finals, I guess. This is, yeah, the final controller, and also here is secured by OAuth. Okay, sorry, I was in the incognito. Okay, here. So now in my season final, I have here my switch for the security OAuth. I can click it. I can decide which scope I want to use. In that case, user impersonation is more than enough. I can authorize it if I do it fast. Maybe I can see, here. Okay, and the password. Okay, I got my here. I guess row. I got my. I didn't see it. Yeah, I got my token back, but I didn't see it from. Okay, let's see here. Okay, I didn't set it up fiddler, but okay, okay, I can see the token here. This is the bearer token that I got from Azure Active Directory, and if I go to jot.io, for example, I can see what are the claims in my and what are the scopes in my token. Okay, come on. So this is my token. Okay, so you see that I got to, this is my scope, the one that I defined, and I got back from Azure Active Directory. Okay, so to recap here, if you want to use Azure Active Directory as authorization server, you have, okay, first to define your API, and then you have to define what is the, in that case, the application that is accessing on behalf of the user to your data, and remembering to enable the implicit flow, and then to add these custom assets to your Swashbuckle custom user interface. Okay, so we come back to the slides. Okay, integrations. Okay, so here I just put some companies, products. So what all of these companies have in common? All of these companies, they have an API management offer, or they are API management product, and they all support the Swagger. Okay, so we normally use API management product to create and then secure the a facade API, a managed facade API on top of our on top of another API, right? So the starting point of any virtualization product is the definition of the underlying service. Okay, in this case, all of these products, they support Swagger. It means that we can automate the definition of the backend service using import function and then export function to make it discoverable. Okay, I want to show here what is the user experience with the Azure API management. So here, Azure API management, it's in here. Okay. Manage. I can take my BBB API too. This is the specification of the Swagger example with Breaking Bad TV series, and I can go to API management, I can import an API, for example, from URL specifying Swagger. I can decide BB. Okay. I have the integration Monday product. So in that way, I'm importing, I define what is the underlying API that I want to virtualize, and that's it. Automatically, if I go to my API management portal, okay, I can go to my automatically generated documentation. I can see my API and try it out, okay, in that way. So this is my built-in console, and again here I can analyze the response code, I can analyze the output, the header, okay, all of the things that I got back from my service call, okay. Coming back here, one is very easy, we saw, to import with API management. Export, it's also very basic and simple. I have to define what is my my format, so Swagger or Waddle. What one of the not good things, let's say, one of the cons of Azure API management is that this endpoint is not discoverable. So if I want to provide to someone else the Swagger that is produced out of Azure API management, I have to send to him a sort of file or publish this file to some browsable resource. It's not this endpoint, it's secured, okay, is available only to admins. This is the address in some way, and then I got my pop-up back. But so I cannot share this endpoint with my team. Okay. Another thing I want to show to you here is the Swagger experience with Sentinet. Is another API management tool that we are using with some customer of us. This is the Sentinet. Again, it's an API management tool. And Swagger has been introduced in the version 4.6, and the version 4.6 will be released in October, so this is a preview. Here I have again my Breaking Bad API, and this is a very simple experience. I can decide to export the JSON format or the YAML format. The good things here compared to Azure API management, that this endpoint is discoverable. So this is my endpoint. Okay, so I can share this endpoint with my team. Okay, so we can use this endpoint. We can use this endpoint to test the API, or with the Swagger UI interface, or we can use other tool like SoapY or like Postman, the tool that we prefer. Here is thinking, but okay, something it will happen. If I want to import, let me check if I have the pet store open here. Let's do it like this. In the meanwhile, I had my Swagger JSON back. If I have the pet store, this is the pet store, I think, yeah. And also the pet store, sorry, the import is very simple. So if I want to add my underlying API, I have to do, so add a service REST. I can use a Swagger from a URL or from file. So I hope that this one is accessible. Okay, there is. Okay. So, and again, this is a similar experience that I showed to you with with Azure API Management, I import my API in that way, so I can then build up my virtualization in that using the metadata downloaded from the Swagger contained in the Swagger JSON file. Okay. So last things that I want to show you here, I have this. This is my local endpoint of my API. It's always the same. Breaking bad. I want to first check it out if it works. In that case, I have my characters back. It takes a while. Something is going on. It's too slow. Okay. No. Okay. What I want to do here is like, just imagine this is my endpoint of my API, so it's a local endpoint. I want to change this virtualization and publish this endpoint on the service bus. So in order to do that, what I can do is just taking this domain alpha, for example, node. Okay, let me do it again. Okay, so publish API USB. Okay, so integration Monday slash maybe. Okay, and then let's find a super easy relay, web relay. This one publish my endpoint on the service bus. Let's say that I don't want anymore my local endpoint. Okay. Did I press save? What did I set it up? I set up. Okay. Okay. So let me review the access control if I. Okay, so I imagine right now that this this endpoint will comes on my service bus. Relay. Integration Monday BB. Okay, that's good. So it means that if I try this get characters. Characters from here. Okay, you will be able to access to my machine from using Azure Service Bus. Okay, that's the things, and I can see here that something is going on. Okay, this is the monitor. Okay, but it's not, I don't want to show you the things because I want to say that another thing. So we expose our API via service bus, but I want to make my Swagger endpoint discoverable on service bus. So again, to recap going here, this is my Swagger endpoint, and the Swagger endpoint is exposed to, so this is my Swagger endpoint, and basically we have this metadata AXD, and then we have a sort of primary key of my service. So this is a normal endpoint, so I can virtualize this endpoint. That's what I'm going to do. Okay, I can create a new virtual service. Okay, it's a REST service, so discoverable swagger on service bus. Okay, very easy. Okay, here I have my metadata endpoint, and I was doing this design modify. Okay, this is my Breaking Bad API. That's the endpoint of my Swagger. Again, I want to publish on the service bus, so this is the endpoint of the data. Okay, so integration day slash session JSON. Sorry, again, I have some problem with the keyboard. Okay, JSON. And again, we can use HTTP, HTTPS with the relay that we like the most. In that case, simple HTTP, make it easy. Okay, I save my stuff, and then if I want, I can expose to everyone, or I can add a simple, in that case I have here, okay, let's make it simple. Let's say that everybody has access to my no, sorry, I press on the wrong button. So apply this access rule. So I enable my, okay, so some operation, but now I imagine that if I go back to my relay, okay, so I have integration-monday.swagger.json. So let me, this is my endpoint. I can check it here. No. Ah, I think I forgot something. Okay, I just create something. Okay, I should change the URI template here. Okay. So this is, now we need to wait 20 seconds, but after 20 seconds my endpoint should be here, I hope. At least, but okay, this is, you can see that was the meaning of the demo show, that we can easily publish our Swagger over endpoint over service bus, and then make it discoverable. Heck, here we are. Now it's working. And then here, for example, in using my Swagger IO editor, I can import and I can, for example, get characters. Let's see. Okay, so I got all of my, I asked to my API that is hosted on my machine through service bus consuming and Swagger JSON that is published on the service bus. Okay, we saw that part. Okay, key takeaways for this session tonight. So for a good developer experience is crucial to build a successful API. So you can generate client SDK, you can generate you can use the Swagger UI interface. That's very all of these things in general are very important, are crucial to build a successful API. We saw that Swagger is the standard, is the de facto standard nowadays to describe this this API. We saw that we can use a Swashbuckle to have to auto-generate as discoverable JSON file, and we can also bundle it with the user interface. And there are a large number we saw of applications and services that are consuming Swagger. Okay, we saw some API management, but there are a really bunch of nice tools like Postman. It works very well with Swagger. There are other nice tools like, let me see if I have it here, like API Transformer, this one, apitransformer.com. You can have different input and convert your Swagger YAML in Swagger JSON or from Waddle to API Blueprint, from Waddle to JSON, just specifying here your thing. So there are a lot of different tool that are built around Swagger. So to finish here, I have some references. So swagger.io, Swashbuckle, API management, and Sentinet by Nivatec. And that's it for today. Thank you.
Hey, Massimo, Mike again. Thank you very much for that. It was a really great session. So we've got a couple of questions that have come in, so I'll go through those with you and just kind of get your thoughts on those. So the